In this video, we introduced the idea of power in physics. Power is just the rate at which work is done, or we could say the rate at which energy is transferred from place to place in a physical system. So we define power as delta W over delta T, where delta W is the increment of work that's been done, and delta T is the time it takes for that work to be done. To express power in terms of calculus, we can just take a really small time increment, and the amount of work done will also be infinitesimal, and we get the expression P equals dW over dt, in other words, the time derivative of the work or energy transfer. The units of power are given by the units of work divided by the units of time, so that comes out to joules per second, and this gets a special name. It's called a watt. It can be confusing to see that capital W standing for the units of power, and the capital W standing for the physical quantity, the work, so watch out for that confusion. To solve basic problems involving power, we simply use the definition to relate the power, the amount of work done or energy transferred, and then the amount of time it takes. So in the first example, we're told that a winch is used to slowly raise a crate of mass 200 kilograms through a height of 15 meters in a time of 2 minutes. And we're asked to compute the average power output for the winch. So the first thing we have to do is figure out how much work this thing did. And notice that we were told this happens slowly, and the reason we're told that is because that allows us to assume the acceleration is approximately zero, and that means the forces balance on this crate. So there's the weight pointing down, and that has a magnitude of mg, or 200 times 9.8, and that gives us 1,960 newtons. Since we know the forces balance here, we conclude the tension is equal to 1,960 newtons as well. And that's a constant force, and it's in exactly the same direction as the displacement vector. That's 15 meters pointing straight up. And so our work is just given by force times displacement. I'll call the displacement a delta y in this case. And we get 1,960 newtons multiplied by 15 meters. And this gives us a total of 29,400 newton meters, but we normally call those joules. And to be consistent in my notation, I'll go ahead and call that work a delta w. Now that we have the amount of work done on this crate, we need to find the time it took to do that work so we can get the power. And we'll use a delta T for the time. And 2 minutes is just 120 seconds. So we have everything we need now to compute the power output of this winch. It did a work of 29,400 joules in a time of 120 seconds. And this comes out to 245 watts. In the next example, we have an electrical appliance. So we have a light bulb. We're told that it dissipates 40 watts of electrical energy. Now the wording is a little strange there. I really should say the power dissipated is 40 watts, or it dissipates 40 joules of energy per second. So given that power of 40 watts, we're asked for the total energy output for this light if it's left on for 24 hours. And finally, we're asked to compute our answer in both units of joules and these strange units of kilowatt hours. And the reason I included those units is because that's actually how your electrical company bills you. So if we look at our power equation, we have that the power is equal to the total work done divided by the time it took. And this might seem a little strange because we're used to talking about work in terms of forces and displacements. And what's going on in the light bulb actually does involve electrical forces and displacements of electrons. But it's more natural here to just talk about this as a change in energy. So an amount of energy transferred divided by the amount of time it took. So we turn it around and we can write that our total energy transfer is given by power multiplied by the amount of time it goes on for. And this light is on for 24 hours, but we need to convert that to seconds before we plug into this equation. So I take my 24 hours and I start multiplying by conversion factors. There's 60 minutes in an hour, 60 seconds in a minute. Everything cancels except the seconds. And I get 86,400 seconds. Now I can wrap things up by taking the power that was 40 watts or 40 joules per second times 86,400 seconds. And this gives me 3,456,000 joules. Now what about the conversion to kilowatt hours? We could go back and figure out a conversion factor between joules and kilowatt hours, but it's actually faster to just redo the calculation in the units of kilowatts and hours. So 40 watts is going to be 0.04 kilowatts, just shifting the decimal point 3 times. And then we have 24 hours of time. And this gives me 0.96 kilowatt hours. So I think my electrical company currently charges around 15 cents per kilowatt hour. So leaving this light on for 24 hours is going to cost me about 15 cents. Next, we want to look at how to interpret a graph of power versus time. So in the picture, we have the power output for some system plotted as a function of time, and the area has a nice interpretation here. If we take a tiny rectangular slice of the area under the curve at a time of t, the height at that time is p of t, in other words, the power at that moment of time, and the width is a small increment delta t. But we already know that a power multiplied by a change in time gives us an amount of work done. So the area of that rectangle represents the work done on a tiny interval of time. Well, now all we have to do to compute the total work done on the time interval t1 to t2 is add up all the rectangles on the interval. And before I do this, I'm going to choose narrower rectangles because I want my approximation to be really accurate. So those of you with some calculus experience will recognize this idea as a Riemann sum. And you might say the area under this curve is given by an integral, and that's the integral of the power as a function of time, starting from t1 and ending at t2. Now, if you're in a trigonometry-based physics course, you can just say the total work is given by the signed area bounded by the curve. And then a typical example would look like the example on the right. So we're given a power function, power as a function of time, but it's a simple enough function where we can compute the area under it without using calculus. So in the problem, we're told that the grid spaces represent milliwatts vertically. So those are thousands of watts, but we can just work with the prefix milli throughout this whole calculation. And the grid spaces represent seconds horizontally. And we're asked to compute the total work done by this electrical motor from t equals 0 to t equals 6 seconds. So we're just looking for the area bounded by this curve. And we definitely don't need any calculus here. We just break it into a rectangle and a triangle. And our rectangle has a width of 3 seconds. And a height of 4 milliwatts. So this rectangle has an area of base times height. Write that as 4 milliwatts multiplied by 3 seconds. And that gives me 12. And then I realize that watts times seconds gives me joules. So I have 12 millijoules. The triangle also has a base of 3 seconds and a height of 4 milliwatts. But the area is given by 1/2 times the base times the height. And this gives me an additional 6 millijoules. And so the total work done by this electric motor on the time interval 0 to 6 is 18 millijoules. We're going to wrap things up with a quick note on a useful formula for power. This formula applies only to the case where force is exerted in order to maintain a constant velocity for an object. For example, a car's motor has to do work to keep it moving at constant velocity. And this is because the motor has to counteract the drag force of the air, the rolling friction on the tires, and so on. So in the picture at the top, we have a car moving along with a constant velocity V, and it's taking a force of F to get this done, in other words, to overcome all those external friction forces. And I've even shown that the car is going to go through a displacement of delta X, and we say that displacement takes a time of delta T to occur. So we can write down the work done by the motor in this car as the force multiplied by the displacement, because the force vector points in the same direction as the displacement vector. The work calculation is that simple. But we know the car is moving at a constant speed, and that means that delta x is going to be v delta t, in other words, rate times time. So we make that substitution, and I find out that the work done is equal to f times v times delta t. Well, I could divide both sides of that by delta t, and I find out that the rate at which work is being done is given by the force used to maintain the speed of the car multiplied by the speed, so F times V. And of course, the rate at which work is done, that's power. So we can write P equals F times V for this special case where a constant force is used to maintain the speed of an object. Finally, we work an example of how to use this little formula. So we're told a car must exert a horizontal force of 1500 newtons on the road in order to maintain a constant velocity of 25 meters per second. And I want to compute the power output of the motor. Finally, we're going to play with units a little bit. I want to state my answer in horsepower using the conversion 1 horsepower is 746 watts. So before I begin, I wanted to address the weirdness of saying that the car must exert a horizontal force on the road. The issue there is to think about how a car is actually propelled. And the story is that the engine ultimately turns the tire. The tire presses backwards against the road. And the external force on the car is then the reaction force using Newton's third law. If the car pushes backwards on the road must push forward on the car in order to maintain its speed. So you could potentially become really concerned here and ask yourself, well, what's doing the work? And I'm just going to go around that rabbit hole and say, I know the source of the energy is the motor in the car. and we compute the power output of that motor using force times speed. The force exerted in order to keep the car moving along at a constant speed is 1500 newtons, and it's moving at 25 meters per second. And notice how the units work out. That's newton meters per second, but a newton meter is a joule, so it's joules per second or watts. When I run the numbers on this, I get 37,500 watts. That might sound like a lot, but when it comes to cars, we can really get perspective by changing to horsepower. So I take my 37,500 watts and I multiply by the conversion factor, 1 horsepower for every 746 watts, and the watts cancel, of course. And keeping 3 sig figs, I get 50.3 horsepower. Now keep in mind, that's not the maximum power output for the engine, so this is actually a pretty realistic number. If you enjoyed this video, or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.